There is something of a theme of education to what we're doing this morning, and these opening words are descriptive of education, titled Autobiography in Five Short Chapters. You've heard this here before. Chapter 1. I walk down the street. There is a deep hole in the sidewalk. I fall in. I am lost. I am helpless. It isn't my fault. It takes me forever to find a way out. Chapter 2. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend I don't see it. I fall in again. I can't believe I'm in the same place, but it isn't my fault. It still takes a long time to get out. Chapter 3. I walk down the same street. There is a deep hole in the sidewalk. I see it is there. I still fall in. It's a habit. My eyes are open. I know where I am. It is my fault. I get out immediately. Chapter 4. I walk down the same street. There is a deep hole in the sidewalk. I walk around it. Last chapter, chapter 5. I walk down another street. That's education. God of Grace and God of Glory is our first hymn. It's number 115. Join in the words of our unison affirmation. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. So be it. Good morning.
Good morning.
Do it again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome. Welcome if you are here for the very first time today, as is Jim Mabry, the president of Middlesex Community College, our special guest today. And welcome as well if you have been here forever. You are welcome here, whatever your circumstances, your race, your age, your sex, your gender orientation, your gender presentation, your immigration status, your documentation status, your politics, your theology. You get the idea. You are welcome here. Whatever is working or not working in your life, it is good to be here together. Again, it's good to have Jim here today. We had hoped to have his wife Judy, but she had the good sense perhaps to be in Florida for this vacation week, even though it was Floridian temperatures here yesterday and the day before. There are some notices in the order of service. Today at 2:00, Martin Henson from the Black Lives Matter movement will be speaking here. He is a representative of the Boston chapter of Black Lives Matter, and that is being co-sponsored by our Racial Justice Roundtable. I'm also told that in the schedule of things coming up this week, the climate justice meeting, originally scheduled for Thursday, has been postponed to the 8th of March. If you are new, there are blue cards in the pews, connection cards, and that's a good way to stay in touch with what is going on around here. And in any and every case, we are glad that you are here this morning. Jim, in a moment, our kids are going to be going off to their classes, so come and stand with me here a second. This is what a college president looks like, in case you were wondering what one looks like. And I know that a number of our families are off doing vacation things here today, but before kids and others go off to their classes, I wanted to have a chance to introduce Jim Mabry. And just as a way of getting the ball rolling here, I asked him if he, from toddlerhood, wanted to be a college president. Did he intend to be a college president? And what did you want to be when you grew up?
It never occurred to me to go into education until much later in life, actually. And I worked a lot of jobs, and I would say probably a lot of you have done that too. Not all of them were fulfilling a specific mission except to get a paycheck at the end of the week. I built houses. I was a carpenter. I framed houses. Through my undergraduate days, I drove a taxi in New York City. I've delivered pizzas. I've worked on telephone systems, a lot of different things. So it takes a long time to find your mission sometimes. And all of those jobs, though, taught me important lessons. They taught me how to work hard. They taught me how to take care of myself. They taught me how to provide service to a very diverse group of people. And through all of those, I learned very important lessons that help me today.
This reading comes from the text of a law that was enacted in Massachusetts in 1647, known as the Old Deluder Law. This was the first public education legislation passed anywhere in North America. This was the humble origins of the public education system as we now know it. It being one chief project of that old deluder, Satan, to keep men from the knowledge of the scriptures, as in former times by keeping them in an unknown tongue, so in these latter times by persuading from the use of tongues that so at least the true sense and meaning of the original might be clouded by false glosses of saint-seeming deceivers, that learning may not be buried in the grave of our fathers in the church and commonwealth, the Lord assisting our endeavors, it is therefore ordered that every township in this jurisdiction, after the Lord hath increased them to the number of 50 householders, shall then forthwith appoint one within their town to teach all such children as may resort to him to read and write, whose wages shall be paid either by the parents or masters of such children, or by the inhabitants in general, by way of supply, as the major part of those that order the prudentials of the town shall appoint, provided those that send their children be not oppressed by paying much more than they can have them taught for in other towns. And it is further ordered that where any town shall increase to the number of 100 families or householders, they shall set up a grammar school, the master thereof being able to instruct youth so far as they may be fitted for the university, provided that if any town neglect the performance hereof above 1 year, that every such town shall pay 5 shillings to the next school till they shall perform this order. Period. That was one sentence. Freely we have received, freely may we give, to support the good work of this congregation here and far beyond these walls. The offering will now be gratefully received.
Thank you.
I had intended to ask for a show of hands. Let's look and see who raises their hands. Jim, how many of you have been students at Middlesex? How many of you have family members who are students at Middlesex? How many of you have taught at Middlesex? A good many of you. How many of you have never been to Middlesex ever and have no idea where Middlesex might be? Right. There's work to do. So I asked Josh to read that 1647 law that established public education in Massachusetts. It being one chief, C-H-I-E-F-E, project of that old, O-U-L-D, deceiver Satan, S-A-T-H-A-N. It being one chief project of that old deceiver Satan to keep men from knowledge of the scriptures, that the true sense and meaning of the original might be clouded by false glosses and saint-seeming deceivers. Does this sound familiar? What does this remind us of? Public education in this Commonwealth was established to protect us from false glosses and saint-seeming deceivers. In other words, public education was established to protect us from fake news. I will give you a copy of this introduction, Jim. I think you will be able to get some mileage out of it. And indeed, when in 1729, the Massachusetts legislature consented to separate Bedford from Billerica and from Concord, it was on two conditions. First, that there be settled a minister of good conversation, and that was Nicholas Bowes. And also, second, that a school be built. Fortunately, we now have a big, beautiful wall that separates church and state, and yet non-sectarian public education was and remains a cornerstone of our Commonwealth and indeed of democracy itself. Public education does protect us from ignorance and fake news. Public education is a corrective to every inequality of income, class, and status. When our society might separate and divide by circumstance or prejudice, public education is our greatest unifier. A year and a half ago, I attended Jim Mabry's inauguration as president of Middlesex Community College, and no doubt many memorable things were said that day by you, most probably, but the observation made by one of the speakers that I most recall is that the United States of America was not originally considered a singular noun. The United States are a nation, it was said at first. And only in time were we to be so unified as to say that the United States is a nation. We live in an era when our nation's unity is under assault. It is our democratic obligation to resist false glosses and saint-seeming deceivers, and it is also our obligation to defend the institutions of democracy, among them the free press and an independent judiciary, and indeed public education. At the top of your order of service, I put a quote from Massachusetts public education pioneer and Unitarian Horace Mann. Education is our only political safety. Outside of this ark, all is deluge. truer words were never spoken. Situated on our town common, First Parish has a unique and historic obligation to affirm public life and the common good. We are a spiritual center with a civic circumference. We have partnered, and we can do more to partner with our cities and towns, with Hanscom Air Force Base, with our VA hospital, and with Middlesex Community College. And so it is a privilege to welcome Jim Mabry, Middlesex's fourth president. Jim and his wife Judy are residents of Bedford and parents of two adult daughters. Jim is an avid triathlete. He asked about the dress code today, and we said that bike clothes would have been fine. He has also been known, I'm told, to purchase a suit for students that might need one. He and Judy are ardent soup makers, black bean and sausage especially. This is a comprehensive introduction. Oh yes, he has a BA and PhD in political science and history from Columbia, a master's from the London School of Economics, and an associate's degree from the University of Maryland. He's lived in New York, London, and Tokyo. Before coming to Middlesex, he was a vice president at Mesa Community College in Arizona, and he has kicked around community colleges in Florida and New York State. He began his career as a high school social studies teacher in the New York City public school system. And today, at Middlesex, he serves more than 13,000 students at campuses in Bedford and in Lowell, where more than 70 degree and certificate programs are offered, as well as hundreds of non-credit courses. If he could find one, Jim wouldn't know what to do with an ivory tower. I have experienced him as warm, welcoming, and engaged. A champion of public education, he is a worthy challenger to that old deceiver, Satan. I bet you have never been introduced in that fashion before. Please welcome Jim Mabry.
That truly was an interesting introduction. And what's really fascinating is, before I get started, I was reading the old deluder law last night. I am a historian by training. I've been reading about this area, and part of my introduction to this community, I've been reading a book called Albion Seed by David Hackett Fisher. And it was really interesting. I was reading the section about worship in the Puritan age in this area, and also about the advent of public education, so that the deluder law came up. Also, it should be noted that each community, each family, was obligated to give a peck of corn to that college in Boston, in Cambridge, excuse me, where both of you attended. So that was a lot of for many families to give each year, but that was how the college was supported. Just one other clarity: my inauguration. Everybody remembers the main speaker, not me. George Stevens was the department chair who first hired me at a community college. He is a real historian who has read deeply into the history of the United States, and somebody who is always a pleasure to spend time with. So to get started today, I just want to thank you all for inviting me to your church today to talk about Middlesex Community College's role in the community. As was mentioned, I started out as a high school social studies teacher and was lucky enough to get a chance to go back to graduate school. Just after completing my PhD, my wife and I were at one of those forks in the road in both of our careers, and I took a one-semester job teaching economics at a community college. Within that one semester, I knew I was home. I had found my place. The rest, as they say, is history. And as the introduction says, I have kicked around in community colleges in New York, Florida, Arizona, and now Massachusetts. You always save the best for last. Today, I'd like to take a few minutes to tell you about why community colleges are so important to all of our communities. But I'm going to give you a few facts in the beginning. I am an academic. To just sort of locate community colleges within the higher education system in this country. And then I'll tell you some good student stories. So there are about 1,100, just over 1,100 community colleges in the United States. They serve about 7 million students in a year. There are 15 community colleges in Massachusetts serving about 127,000 students in a year. Community colleges educate about 40% of all undergraduates in this country, and about half, just over half, of all undergraduate students at public higher education in Massachusetts are in community colleges. Middlesex Community College was founded in 1970 in a couple buildings at the VA hospital. I've heard some really interesting stories about those days. We now have two campuses in Bedford and Lowell, each serving in a given semester about 4,500 students. We have 19 buildings overall, 11 on our beautiful 200-acre campus off of Springs Road. Our students come from the surrounding communities and on average travel no more than 8 miles to get to class. There is no public transportation service to either campus. Our average age is 26. 50% of our students are first generation in college, meaning they're the first one in their family to attend college. Only about 10% of our students go full time. Many are low income, and almost all are working while they're in college. Many take care of families, and many are working, taking care of families, and going to school at the same time. About 60% of our students come to us planning to take a transfer degree and go on and get a 4-year degree. About 20% plan to go straight into the workforce. They go into popular career programs like nursing, dental hygiene, biotechnology, cybersecurity, and graphic design. These are programs that with 2-year degrees, you can get really good jobs, and they lead to great and rewarding careers. Our student body is wonderfully diverse. At last year's graduation, we had students representing 56 different countries. Our oldest graduate was 71, and our youngest was 17. The 17-year-old graduated from high school the week after she graduated from MCC. So a few economic facts. We have a $57 million budget. We employ about 1,200 people, both full and part-time. The economic impact of MCC, according to a recent study, is about $178 million a year. The state support that we get covers about 38% of our budget. State funding per pupil in Massachusetts has declined 31% over the last 15 years. This means that the cost of education is increasingly being borne by our students. Tuition at public institutions goes up because state support goes down. I think we have an excellent value proposition at the community college. We charge 50% less than a state university. Our median debt is zero for our students. Plus, we have small classes, professors who like to teach, and they help students. That's part of what they do. And we have a level of diversity you won't find at any other institution. Now, let me tell you a few student stories. This is my favorite part. Because, you know, as a president, you can get away from the students. But I grew up as a teacher. I came up through the classroom. And it's always been something I've worked very intentionally on to make sure that I keep in touch with who our students are. So, Robbie, he was a fun-loving young man who bragged about taking 6 years to get a 2-year degree. So in his last 2 years, though, he got involved in the honors program, started doing community service, got into doing service learning projects, and really got connected both from his studies to what he wanted to do in the community. For his academic prowess, but mostly for his community service work, he got a full scholarship to Columbia University. He graduated about a year and a half ago, and he worked in a university research lab for a year after that. This fall, he started a PhD program in molecular biology at Princeton. Who knew? I mean, I don't think Robbie from Mesa, Arizona, ever expected he was going to end up in a PhD program at Princeton. That not only changed his life, but his older brother, who dropped out of college, went back and got his engineering degree at Arizona State University. So we see this transformation affect not just individuals, but the families. Brian was another student in Arizona. He was sort of a nerdy loner, I guess I'd call this guy. He walked into our campus at 26. He had not been in school since high school. He was disaffected from his family. 2 years later, Brian's calling me up going, "Dr. Mabry, I'm turning down the offer from Columbia." I'm going, "Brian, how come?" He goes, "Well, their robotics program, it's just not that good. It's only top 15 in the country." Now, I knew Brian pretty well at that point, so I said, "Okay, what's the plan?" And he said, "Well, University of Illinois is making me a good offer. They're top 5 program in the United States. I'd rather be in New York, but I'll go to Illinois." 4 years after walking in our door, this kid has an AS degree, a BS degree, and they put him right in their top 5 PhD program. Right? When I sit down at dinner with him and talk to him, I say, "Brian, like, how many languages do you program in?" Because I'm a history major. I have no idea what he's doing. He says, "Well, I program in all of them." Okay. Yeah? I mean, who knew, right? You keep the door open because you have no idea who's walking through. And these two, sort of like me, had no idea what they were capable of when they got in that door. Let me tell you about a few students locally here at, this is now my second MCC, right? I'm really happy to report that when I left Mesa Community College, the department chairs there gave me a set of MCC cufflinks. I mean, how perfect was that? I wore them at my inauguration, and I took a picture of them and emailed it to the head of the department chair association. And, you know, it's just really nice to see that these things can work. So Diego is a warm-hearted student with a really infectious smile. He and his family immigrated here from Guatemala. Nobody in the family spoke much English. He and his father worked together in a McDonald's at first. He came to our college. He went through the ELL program in one semester. He graduated in 2 years from our biotechnology program. Within that 2 years, his father overcame a serious bout of cancer. Diego's now a scholarship student at Boston College in their biotechnology program, and his goal is to find a cure for cancer. Maria is a very determined young woman from the Dominican Republic. She came to us as a good student, but a very shy Latina. But she decided that she was going to work on that. She got involved. She became a student tutor. She's worked in a number of offices at the college. She interned at Representative Nikki Tsongas's office. She internship in the Lowell Mayor's office. She is engaged in every program possible at the college. What I love about these students is they are the future of this country. They come here, they work hard, they are grateful for the opportunities, and they take advantage of everything they can. I was talking to Diego not long ago. He said, Boston College has got all these great lecture series. I'm trying to go to these things and all. Diego works almost full time at a biotechnology program in Lexington. He's a student in a very tough program, a science-based program there. He's still finding time to soak up everything he can. They're what the American dream is about. They are strivers in the best sense of the word. They're thankful for these opportunities, and they will make a positive difference in our world. My wife and I have gotten to know both Diego and Maria quite well, and they joined our family for Thanksgiving dinner last November. Now, Kenny was an interesting student. He wandered into our office area in Lowell on a Friday afternoon when nobody else was around. I saw him standing there with a piece of paper in his hand, and I walked out and said, could I help you? And he said, well, I got this letter, and I'm on a list, and I don't know what I did, right? So I looked at the piece of paper. Turns out he'd made Dean's List. He had no idea what this meant, right? The words did not have any relevance for him. When I explained it to him, he said, well, I never made the honor roll in high school. I said, well, what are you doing? He said, well, I'm staying after school. I'm doing my homework. I went to tutoring a couple of times to get some help and all. Kid's got a 3.5 GPA. He has no idea, right? His parents are immigrants from Cambodia. I've now met his parents, Kenny, who got a scholarship last spring, and his sister. And again, these are wonderful students who will make a difference. Now, it really is true that from MCC, you can go anywhere. And last year, when I was speaking at an undergraduate commencement at Columbia University, two students came up afterwards and said, I started at Middlesex Community College. Three others came up and told me they'd started at the community college I worked at in New York. So you really can get there from the community college world. Every year, we send students to elite privates like Smith, Wellesley, and Columbia. But we also send a lot of students to some of the wonderful and excellent public colleges we have, like UMass Amherst and UMass Lowell. So you can get anywhere from MCC. Now, let me speak a little bit about our role in transforming our community. From your mission, and from some of your previous speakers, you know that marginalized communities react in very similar ways, whether you talk about Native American communities, African American communities, immigrant communities, communities that have suffered from mass incarceration, or even victims of globalization. Hopelessness breeds despair. Despair breeds self-destructive behavior. We see all too much of that in our communities today. I'm saying if you give people a chance, you give people hope, you give people a hand, they will, more often than not, take that chance and start down that path to success. But you really have to make that chance and that path visible and accessible. You have to make it a reasonable chance so that people don't see this as too far or out of reach or impossible for them. Our open access mission, being part of the community and being close to home, make it an easy first step for many of our students. Our low cost and the aid available from federal Pell Grants, from veterans benefits, and the local scholarships that we provide means that we are not financially out of reach for most of our students. We offer a broad range of programs, from one-year certificates to two-year degrees to transfer degrees. We also provide flexible scheduling and alternatives like evening and online and weekend that more traditional colleges cannot. We are also, quite happily, the place where people start over, people start again, And people start what they were unable to start or finish the first time or an earlier time. Maybe they had too much fun that first time at college. Maybe they were raising a family. Maybe they were laid off a job they had for many years. These are all common scenarios for the students that we serve. Many students do not take, or I should say most students do not take that straight and narrow path through higher education. Only 12% of students in this country go full-time and graduate in 4 years. We call those traditional students. They're 12%. Hey, it took me 3 colleges in 10 years to get my bachelor's degree. But it's also the welcoming environment that we create on our campuses, full of people of all ages, all colors, in all backgrounds. Our small classes, we have average class size of 23. We don't have large lecture halls. We have faculty who love to teach. We have faculty who enjoy working with their students outside the classroom. We have very strong student support services. And we work every day to engage students and pull them in. I've heard over and over from students that it was one person who reached out and pulled me in. These people are there every day changing lives. Now, we work very hard to get students engaged because all the research shows that students who are engaged and connected succeed. We're a commuter school. People have busy lives. They come and they go. We reach out all the time trying to get them connected to the college. If they could get connected to a professor, to a program of study, to a club or an organization or an activity, they have a much greater chance of succeeding. And because many of our students are first generation and low income, they are not always great advocates for themselves. They don't know the language like Kenny, who had no idea what a dean's list was. They don't know the questions to ask. So like many colleges, we help them advocate for themselves. But also like many colleges, we have an honors program, a student government, and leadership programs to give engaged students further opportunities to learn and grow. Each year, I help provide the leadership students for the annual Advocacy Day down on Beacon Hill. This is so much fun. I mean, these students are so engaged and so involved. They ask a million questions. And I go through all the usual stuff, but what I tell them is, tell your story, because their stories are much more compelling than the facts and figures. I apologize for those facts and figures. But they, you know, and last year, I remember Diego and Maria came back after going down to Beacon Hill, and they go, it worked. They said, we were paired up with some UMass Lowell students who weren't very well prepared and just cited some basic facts and figures. Maria and Diego went in and told their stories. The legislators sat up and listened. This made a difference. They will remember that. These students, as I said, are a blast to work with because they are so hungry to learn and so grateful for the chance to learn more. This is the work we come in for every day at Middlesex. We engage directly and provide a safe and supportive environment for all our students. And this makes the community college the front line as a provider of hope, opportunity, and transformation in our community. In conclusion, I realize that not all people are as lucky as I am and get to lead an organization where people truly believe in the mission. And not many people get to work every day with people who are willing to go over and above to help another person succeed. I see this happen every day at the college. And it never ceases to amaze me how much people give of themselves to help their students transform their lives. I get to work in a richly diverse environment, a richly diverse learning environment, where students are really front and center of what we do every day. From my first day in the classroom as a high school social studies in a really tough urban area, to now at MCC, it's really about finding ways for every student to succeed. The mission doesn't change, it's just the scope and scale. MCC may not be the right place for every student, but it is a welcoming and great place to learn for many students, and you can be assured that we will be there holding the door open. Thank you.
Again, let's get coffee and then come back in here and have some back and forth with Jim. Wonder Still, The World Shall Witness, our concluding hymn is number 139. Nothing else matters much. Not wealth or education or even health without this gift. This is the final deposit and distillation of every faith and every creed that somehow, we keep zest in living. May it be so. Amen.